Tide pools. When we think of tide pools, we think of high tides and low tides. Waterline is high at one point and low at another. But what makes a tide pool a tide pool? How is it different from, say, a sandy beach? I mean, both are like, both have waves go up and down. I mean, like, why can't a sandy beach be like the same thing as a tide pool? Tide pools exist in the intertidal zone, where the waterline rises and falls. When shorelines recede from the high tide to low tide, they leave behind sessile animals and small pools, forming the tide pools. These little pools are full of trapped marine animals, fish, shrimp, and more, forming their own little ecosystem separate from the rest of the ocean. But why tide pools? Why did we even become fascinated with these little tiny shore puddles? I mean, puddles are like everywhere. It'd be raining, I'd look down and think, there's little worms and bugs swimming in that puddle, right? Their own little ecosystem, and like something like a tide pool. Oddly enough, tide pools have been a huge deal with Great Britain during the mid-1800s. The first public aquarium ever in the world was opened in England's Regent Park's garden in 1853. With that, Britain went into a marine and seaside craze. The seashore became a popular leisure spot among the middle class. It was a way for them to observe the marine animals in the wild without having to dive into the water. I mean, like, not everywhere likes to get wet. I mean, like, I don't want to have to, like, swim and risk myself drowning just to, like, look at fish. They could watch how the marine animals live in their own natural habitat up close in the water. Kind of like a fishbowl made by nature for us to look at. Let's look at one food chain that happens inside the tide pools. We got your primary producer, the brown algae kelp, then the primary consumer, the glass shrimp, which eats the brown algae kelp. This is the secondary consumer, the California two-spot octopus that eats glass shrimp. We'll first look at the beginning of the food chain, the primary producer. Brown algae kelp, otherwise known as Macrocystis porifera, is part of the phylum Heterocontophyta and the class Phaeophysia. Being the primary producer of the tide pool ecosystem, the brown algae kelp is a photoautotrophic organism, absorbing the sunlight for energy. Brown kelp uses generally four certain structures to keep itself anchored and upright: the stipe, the blade, the air sac, and the holdfast. The stipe works similar to the stem of a plant, transporting materials and providing structure. The blade acts similar to plant leaves, increasing the surface area for chlorophyll to absorb more light. The air sac contains not-so-dense gas to act like a buoy and lift the whole organism. This allows the kelp to keep itself upright and pull itself closer to the sun. Lastly, there is the holdfast, the part that anchors the kelp to the ground. So it's kind of like the roots of a plant, except it's not. Kelp can only use the holdfast for anchoring, while the plant uses its roots to also take in nutrients from the soil. Biologists Hugo L. Borales and Christopher S. Loben examined the range of depth in which the Microcystis porifera could survive. They found that kelp to be depths from just above the lowest tide to 15 meters below the surface. The kelp need a hard substrate for the holdfast to attach to, so kelp beds were found on rocks in not so deep areas. Since deeper levels lack hard substrates, kelp could not grow because anything like a current could pull the kelp right out of the loose sand. Since tide pools have rocks practically everywhere, they make a nice environment for the kelp to attach and grow. As a primary producer, Macrocystis porifera plays an important role in providing the energy to the marine ecosystem. Biologist Michael H. Graham from UC Davis examined the relationship between the diversity of marine species and the kelp forests. When he deforested the kelp, the number of marine species dropped significantly. He concluded that the structure and the rapid growth rate of the kelp supported the majority of the coastal marine food web. This allows it to become an abundant food supply to tide organisms. Can you think of a tide organism that feeds on kelp? Yep, you guessed it. It is a glass shrimp, otherwise known as Palaemonetes. Palaemonetes are part of the phylum Arthropoda and the class Malacostraca. They can generally be found hiding under tiny rocks or vegetation for protection. Since glass shrimp eat primarily brown algae and other phototrophic organisms, it can be classified as a primary consumer. However, glass shrimp are willing to eat anything else when brown algae becomes scarce, such as aquatic bugs or detritus. This willingness to feed on organic waste has made glass shrimp popular in aquariums, since they clean the tank from fish waste and algae. As much as they play the role as the primary consumer in the tide pool food web, they also play the important role of detritivores in the energy cycle. Although a majority of palimonite species are freshwater shrimp, some live in brackish or somewhat salty waters. Glass shrimp that live in tide pools are brackish shrimp because the water in the tide pools come from the salty ocean. The species that live down in San Pedro, California is the palimonite hiltoni. Since glass shrimp tend to be rather abundant, they are the primary food source for carnivorous fish. The defensive feature that earned them the name glass shrimp is a transparent body. The glass body camouflages the shrimp, making it really hard for visual predators to see it and not through it. This also earns it the other nickname, ghost shrimp, since it seems to be barely there. Since ghost shrimp have such a strong camouflage defense, it primarily comes out to feed at night. However, some animals can still catch and eat the ghost shrimp regardless. Can you think of a tide pool organism that eats glass shrimp? You're probably thinking of a carnivorous fish, but for the sake of this video, we're going to talk about octopuses instead. The California two-spot octopus, or the Octopus bimaculatus, is a common tide pool organism off the coast of California and gets its name from the two spots under each eye. It is part of the phylum Mollusca and the class Cephalopoda. Since the two-spot octopus prefers sandy ground and rock caves tided, tide pools make a perfect environment to live in. Like other octopuses, the two-spot octopus can use its chromatophores to change color and texture when hunting for prey or hiding from predators. If being hunted, the octopus will either camouflage itself or flash warning signals. When hunting, the octopus actively searches or camouflages itself. It suddenly grabs the prey with its suckers and pierces it with its radula, injecting a paralyzing toxin. The two-spot octopus hunts primarily snails, crustaceans like the glass shrimp, bivalves, limpets, or in general, anything with a hard shell. So its radula has been adapted to drill a small hole into the poor little mollusk and inject the toxin into it. Well, there you have it. Tide pools are an example of a food chain. If you want to learn more about tide pools or one of the organisms from this video, you can find the reference in the description below. Otherwise, thanks for watching.